Hallo und herzlich willkommen auf dem FEM-Kanal und zu unserem ersten Talk heute von Margot.
Margot hat irgendwann mal and welcome to the FEM-Channel.
Und ist dann irgendwann
and our first talk today. It is made by Margot, who at some point started with Freifunk and has then started to do lots of other things and is now at the C3 infrastructure team, so is actually right now also working on the RC3 world and everything on that backend. That's why this talk is also not going to have a Q&A. This talk is pre-recorded and Margot is going to be busy with operating the RC3 world. This is about IPv6 and not just about combination with IPv4, but in this case it is about only IPv6 networks, and they are going to give a bunch of experiences and things they learned.
Under language selection, select the first translated option to hear the English translation. Und jetzt viel Spaß beim Talk mit Margot.
And now, have fun with the talk.
Schön, dass ihr eingeschaltet habt zu meinem Talk Legacy IP.
Yeah, hello. I'm Margot. Thank you for coming to this talk, Legacy IP. But legacy IP doesn't exist anymore, but no network is also not a solution. So what is this about? How do I operate a real IP with IPv6 focus, or ideally IPv6 only? My experiences, what problems I've found, what solutions, and also a bit of inspiration that you might use for your own networks, so you can maybe also create an IPv6 only network. So before we start, a bunch of disclaimers. In this talk and also in my network, we're talking about the real internet. So we have an AS, we have an IP space, and we operate BGP with the rest of the internet. So this entire stuff is not a plaything. The operation of an AS is not just clicking yourself a VM somewhere and installing VM and a web server. So please think about whether you actually can do that and if you can carry the responsibility for that, and especially also if you need that. Pay attention to knowing what you're doing. So, like when training and trying things with BGP, there's the AS1042. Which is a virtual overlay network for playing, but please don't do this in the public internet. So, next up, terminologies. In this talk, I will use a couple of terms a lot, which is IP, meaning real IP, meaning IPv6, which is the 128-bit variant. And if I talk about legacy IP, I mean IPv4, which is the old 32-bit variant. Okay, so how did all of this start? At some point in 2020, I thought, infrastructure, I'm doing that for a while now, a bunch of years. DN42, I also tried doing for a while and collected a bunch of things and experiences. I also collected a lot of services that required reworking and rebuilding at some point, so I thought it might be time for a real network. So what do I need for a real network? I will need an autonomous system. If I become a right member, I can get that. If I might need a connectivity, so somewhere I need to get IP addresses and I need to bring them into the internet. In some way, there are virtual machines with ISP points. There are virtual machines with BGP upstream, so that's all possible. And lastly, I do need IP addresses. For real IP, that's not a problem. You can get, there are lots of them to get. RIPE will give you a /48 PI network, which is connected to your organization, but not to a provider that will give it to you.
Legacy IP addressen oder auch IPv4 addressen genannt.
So we have those networks. And now let's get to legacy IP, maybe. Those don't exist anymore. If you look at the RIPE website, you will see that how many RIPE members are waiting for new IPv4 addresses. You can see that the waiting list is getting longer and longer, and apparently today there's a new high point just as yesterday and the day before. And also the used market for IPv4 addresses is not great. You're paying around at least a two-digit price in medium size for an individual IPv4 address, depending on prefix size, of course. But IPv4 is, for a private best effort project, not really an option. So, what to do? Let's just use only IPv6, because that's what we have. That's not a problem and easy to get.
Hab dann so eine kleine Liste an Diensten, die ich betreibe.
What should my network do? So I made a small list of services I want to host. Of course, a web server with a blog, a Nextcloud, a Hedgehog, which runs this application, a mail server.
Aber wenn man sich diese Liste anguckt,
that we will get to later.
Tatsächlich Menschen.
And a few other things that are needed. But if you look at this list, you notice people use it. It's not for me just for fun. It's actually something people use.
Nutzer der Dienste nur Legacy IP haben.
So,
wir haben ja eben gesagt, wir machen IPv6 only Nets.
What do if the users of the service only have Legacy IP? We have said we have an IP only Nets.
Schönen Banner auf meinem Blog.
Step one,
falls ihr es nicht lesen
just mildly serious.
Diese Seite mit einem veralteten IPv4,
you can see this header on my blog, which says you visit this blog with Legacy IP. Maybe in the future you will have problems with availability.
So ein Marketingproblem, wenn ein Netz oder ein Provider
kein
IPv6 können, also keine Legacy IP anbieten. Und
you make it damit wird sich das a marketing lösen, problem if a network or provider doesn't support IP6.
Wie gesagt, ist nicht so ganz ernst gemeint, aber falls ihr das auch machen wollt,
that's a nice Twitter discussion, to be honest.
Nginx,
it's not really serious, but if you want to do that,
ob der Request per richtigem IP oder per Legacy IP kam.
Nginx,
und wenn er rausfindet, dass der Request per Legacy IP kam,
an option for real IP or Legacy IP.
Body tag mit diesem
Banner, and if it notices that the request was Legacy IP,
ist eine nette Spielerei,
it will
add
the banner to the body tag.
Naja, also Step 1, naja.
It's a fun thing, but it isn't useful if not many people do it. So, do we need Legacy IP everywhere? No. That's what Step 2 is for, an L4 proxy. The idea is that a small number of boxes will have a Legacy IP address. I call them gateways.
Die Anfragen an die Legacy
and on these boxes you have Nginx,
heißt,
and they distribute the requests to Legacy IP addresses on a port basis. So if a TCP port 80 request comes from Legacy IP, Nginx knows to which server with real IP to relate.
Eine neue IP-Adresse, eine neue
IP-Adresse,
dann kann man es ja nicht mehr auseinandersetzen.
One of them for every service that has a used port.
Dass ich mir da ein zentrales VWS-Proxy
which of course means
habe,
that you
viel zu viele
for
brauche, um das
HTTP and HTTPS.
Ich habe da auch mal eine Beispiel-Config
to set up a proxy.
Das ist nicht der Standard Nginx HTTP.
Here's an example config.
Eben auf Layer 4, also TCP.
You can see an Nginx stream block. That's not the standard HTTP part.
DNS-UDP,
it's only for Layer 4 TCP or UDP.
Ein Server, in dem Fall V6 only natürlich.
You can specify an upstream DNS
und sagt dem Nginx dann
UDP,
hier ist er bitte auf diese IP-Adresse UDP und Port.
And then it tells the Nginx that for this IP address there's the UDP port. And this 10.3 is of course only an example. And then that passes it on to the corresponding backend. And then here there's the TCP variant. So this is really not any witch's work. So what does this look like? On the internal services that are not supposed to be viewable from the outside, they only have a public V6 address. So if we have DNS, then we have a hidden primary here, which is only a singular IPv6 address, which is configured there, and that's where it is reachable, but it doesn't really need IPv4 if there are no end users that are going to request it from IPv4. Then we have a secondary service here that is supposed to be viewable by users. The host name and the IP of the user is still of the machine itself continues to be V6 only. And then end users will maybe also get a separate host name, like ns1.example.com, and that will one file use the read address in some way, which will directly contact the host. And then there's an IPv4 address which will go to this Nginx gateway, which will is then configured to listen on this port, on port 53 of course, and will pass it on. So, how do these servers talk to the outside? Because we covered how the clients will talk to the server. So, the problem is there are endpoints that maybe don't have real IP. There is a well-known Git website that is still not operable from IPv6. And so we use the same procedure as every time, which is NAT, which is the solution to all networking problems. So we don't use NAT v4, we use NAT64 is what it's called. So we have an address translation between the IPv6 and the IPv4 address space. There are lots of talks and literature about this and how it works, so I'm not going to go into much detail here. But this is also used in the Telekom mobile network, and they do it by default there. So the how I realize it is that I have a common prefix, which is a V6 prefix, where the entire V4 address room is represented within the IPv6 address. And the V6.4 gateways will announce this prefix so that devices that route back there know where to arrive. And if an IPv6 only box will try to access an IPv4 resource, it will just request the DNS resolver that is able to give back the proxying address. And there are plenty of DNS servers that will return V6 encapsulated V4 addresses.
Und von außen nach innen. Gucken wir uns die Übersicht nochmal an.
And that's basically it. We can communicate from the inside out and from the outside in. So let's have a look at the overview again. If you see down there, there's our big IPv6 network, which uses OSPF and IBGP. We have a regular edge router that routes IPv6 addresses to the outside and inside. V6 end user will always just use that edge router and directly access the services. And there we also see a legacy end user. They will use the TCP UDC legacy to V6 proxy, which is this Nginx proxy thing that I showed earlier. And then on the left side, there is what I just explained, how native V6 only services can communicate with legacy only resources, which is a NAT64 gateway, which is also at the edge of the IPv6 only network. And needs a DNS64 solver before as well. So would be way too nice if that just worked out of the box and there were no problems at all. So there were problems and how did I solve them?
Mail servers are complicated via DNS, reverse DNS, and everything has to work. On the same time, email is a very critical service. So from the beginning, I said this one will not have IPv6 only, it will get an IPv4 itself or run outside. So think about it well if you want to run a mail server yourself. It's not very easy, it might be very tricky.
Ein weiteres Problem, was ich hatte mit der Net
to have an available and working mail server. Another problem I had with the software Matrix Synapse, which is a Matrix home server for instant messaging. In general, it would run on IPv6, but the emails are not compatible with Happy Eyeballs. So if you try to connect with a legacy IPv6 address,
wird die einfach
it can't be found via legacy IP.
Kann's nicht erreichen. Habe ich noch nicht gelöst, gibt ein GitHub-Issue dazu.
So it just stops working.
Müsste man wahrscheinlich mal etwas
it will not reach it.
Und dann ist auch das
I haven't fixed, solved it, there's a GitHub-Issue for that. Somebody should invest Docker some time
so Thema,
for that,
wenn man das
but right now it's broken.
Läuft dann per V6, per
Docker is another wirklich. Topic. If you configure it and invest a lot of time, it will run. By default, it doesn't.
Weniger doll ist das Ganze
so,
mit GitLab Runnern. Ich habe mal versucht,
if you want, it can work.
In dieses V6 Only Netz zu stellen.
It's less nice with GitLab Runners. I've tried integrating a GitLab Runner into the IP6 Only Net, but the communication with the container didn't work if you had a Docker container or needed one.
Alles ganz schrecklich.
Eventually, you had to rolled back to IPv4.
Wenn ich per HTTPS
so for now it's broken.
Eben nicht über,
another topic is
DNS machen will, sondern über ein
if you have HTTPS traffic, but it's not over DIN DNS,
ja, Jump Host nenne ich's mal,
but over a directly connected VPN host.
Only Teil, das funktioniert
it's a little tricky. Depending on how you construct it,
ein Reverse Proxy Chaining, also quasi ein NAT für HTTP, zu bauen.
But I didn't get around Reverse Proxy Chaining, halt which is a NAT for HTTP,
genau,
which isn't nice. There should be other solutions, but for now,
das ist jetzt nicht mehr so stark auf IPv6 only.
So now for the last part. Connectivity, Routing and Administration.
Mit,
that's not very IPv6 centered. I have two
Transit für V6 ist relativ günstig. Gratis V6 Transit ist zumindest
one IXP VM in Frankfurt.
Und dann habe ich noch weitere Projekte
and one, for Transit
mit billigem Compute, also wo die ganze Rechenleistung
and steht, I have another project
habe, zum
with cheap
heißt,
computing,
ich muss irgendwie zwischen diesen beiden Standorten
where I don't have BTP, können. For example, at Hexner.
Da musste ich mehr, weil ich nichts Besseres habe.
So I have to communicate between these two locations.
Waren intern,
so I had to use WireGuard for a WireGuard overlay. WAN and intern are divided over policy-based routing,
gibt da auf der WireGuard mailing list eine Diskussion, die ist
which is better for
also
separating the view of the own network and the Hetzner network.
Das ist auch nicht so sonderlich großartig. Und es frisst natürlich
WireGuard doesn't support VRF right now.
Genau, ihr wollt, wenn ihr sowas macht,
there is a discussion on the mailing list.
Haben, um Leaks zu unterbinden. Das heißt, ihr wollt nicht versehen.
Exactly, connectivity. You want strict firewall rules to suppress leaks.
Mit eurer Source,
so you don't want to
das
send
uncool, weil Hetzner weiß
packets from the internal network to the Hetzner default gateway.
Hetzner ist das ja ein externes Netz.
That's because Hetzner doesn't know what your AS.
Also da wirklich aufpassen.
For Hetzner is an external network, because you don't have a BGP upstream.
Genau, mein Routing mache ich mit
so pay attention
Linux,
to
OSPF als Interior Gateway,
what you have there.
Zwischen allen größeren Standorten.
I do my routing with Bird 2
wesentlichen Geschmackssache.
And OSPF as
auch verschiedenste Möglichkeiten.
IGP. IBGP genau, between larger locations.
Benutzt Konfigurationsmanager.
There are different options.
Stack mit Ansible oder anderen Tools.
Again, the topic administration. I use SaltStack.
Da kriegt ihr dann in die BGP.
It's also possible with other tools.
Firewall-Regeln keine Konsistenz mehr.
But it really can grow fast. You don't get consistency into your BGP configs and firewall rules.
So
make sure your system runs stable.
Weg von den IXP VMs.
Let's get to the end. Was
da steht und so, oder auch what would be cool to do? It would be ideal to get away from IXP VMs to actual hosts, to actual running metal, which is of course a bit more expensive, but maybe an option for the future. And also real layer 2 transport instead of using overlays would be really neat. It would then not use all of the MTU. But also not really trivial and also not very cheap. So, but if possible and if it is used productively, it should, really should be done. Rather than this best effort approach. Okay, so let's get to the conclusion. Would I do it again? Yes, v6 only with only a few legacy IP edges is really makes sense. It is doable and in a reasonable fashion. Cost-wise, it's probably also really makes sense since legacy IP often is a bit more expensive and many providers will fairly soon charge more for legacy IP, and then only having legacy IP on the edge nodes is actually also possible. So the layout that I did with the IXP VMs and the tunnels is okay for private best effort things, but not really suitable for productive networks, anything that actually earns money, for example. For that you need actual peerings, actual layer 2 transport, actual hardware, stuff like that. But that's not really what the goal of this was. And yeah, that's basically it. Thank you very much for watching and listening. If you have any questions, you can send me an email to rc3@ipv6.church.
Es gibt leider kein Q&A.
And that's how we're back here. Thank you to Margot for the talk. There will be no Q&A because this Margot is involved in RC3 infrastructure, but you can send him an email to the email address that was shown. The next talk will be at 7 p.m. with the C3 news shows and then networks as data sources. That's it. Bye. This talk was translated for you by Ku and Oscar. Thank you for listening. We like to have feedback for our translations. You can leave it under the hashtag C3Lingo on Twitter and Mastodon. Thank you very much and have a nice time at RC3. Bye.